Your Steve Jones Show podcast will start shortly. The Steve Jones Show podcast is sponsored by Brewers Outlet, your beverage supermarket on Reagan Street in Sunbury. Sports talk where your voice counts. This is the Steve Jones Show on News Radio 1070 WKOK. Now from the Sunbury Motor Studio, here's Steve Jones.
Sunbury Motors, 4th Street in Sunbury. Sunbury Motors Kia, routes 11 and 15 in Hummel's Wharf. Great to have you with us today. We'll talk about the NFL draft today. We'll mock draft. My brother's on today. Ben Jones, StateCollege.com, will join us as well. So another full show on tap. No show tomorrow as the Phillies take on the Washington Nationals. I think the airtime in that is, what, 3:35 or something like that?
You are correct, sir.
Plus, I mean, to be honest with you, Sean said something about the game is past, or the show's past his bedtime, so they're, you know, I'm like, okay.
You confusing my bedtime with your brother's bedtime? Oh. I mean, no, seriously, he said it's 7 o'clock, lights out.
It's 7 a.m.
That's true, he only said 7.
Yeah, you have to let him, you know, like, play it out all the way through. That way you know what it is. So, that Dan Patrick, I mean, yeah, Dan Patrick's absolutely right that one of the key, these seasons are now so long. But baseball's been 162 games since 1961, and the NBA has been 82 as long as I know it. I thought the NHL was 80 at one point, now they're 82. And football, of course, is 16. But there's another factor that comes into play here, and the factor is this. Local and regional television enters into this. If you are NESN, YES, Root Sports, CSN, you know, the networks down in D.C., whatever, Fox Sports Midwest, whatever, well, you thrive on having inventory. Inventory is live sports. Yes has the Nets and the Yankees. Well, that's 82 regular season games for the Nets. It's 162 for the Yankees. Now, there'll be a little overlap here and there, but let's just take the basics. You're talking about 240 days out of a 365 that are filled with live sports. I mean, NESN has the Bruins and the Red Sox. CSN, they have what, the Phillies, the Flyers, and the Sixers. Root Sports has the Penguins and the Pirates. Well, they're already paying a lot of money, and we talked about the fact that the value of franchises, we went through that, the Forbes article the other day, Forbes, which is often quoted on this show. I asked the suit one time about Forbes. He said he only looks for the pictures. I'm like, well, what does that mean? But when you look at the value of franchises, 23 now are worth $1 billion or more. Well, a big part of that happens to be the local TV deals they have cut. Regional local sports networks need the inventory. Thus, they need to win the bidding to get programs on the air. If you have two different sports encompassing spring, summer, fall, winter, you're talking 240 days of live programming a year, not including the preseason. But you're, that's 240 days a year you're getting live programming out of 365. And you can fill in the gaps in the other 125. You can pick up a college package. I mean, there's many things you can do. But that's what they need to thrive, survive, and sell. If they don't have, let's take Root Sports in Pittsburgh. If they don't have the Pirates and the Penguins, they can't sell it. I mean, nobody's going to watch Root Sports to watch Candlepins for Cash. That's not going to happen. You know, same thing with Nesson. Nesson is the Bruins and the Red Sox. Then they mix in, obviously, some college stuff up there. They do that. But it is, I mean, that they're bidding big money for all of this inventory. Of course, they pass it along to you, the consumer, through higher cable fees and so forth, and advertising. But for them, they don't want to see a reduction in the season. You know, their rights fee is based on 162 baseball games. Their rights fee is based on 82 hockey games or basketball games. That's what it's based on. That's what allows these local regional sports networks to survive, is the live sports that they're able to put on. And that's something that's not talked a lot about. But look, television runs so much of this. And that, there's just no getting around it. I mean, there's no getting around it. Television runs how sports are operated.
What?
And if you're sitting there and you have any question about it, all right, what time is the kickoff of the Akron game to open the season for Penn State? Anybody know yet? No. Nobody knows. Because television hasn't told them yet what time the game is kicking off. Will there be some Friday night Big Ten games this year? Well, because it's part of the television deal. I've always felt that leagues and conferences, leagues have a little bit more control, but I've always felt that college football conferences have lost control of their game because they let television dictate when games are played, what time games are played. And that to me is a problem. It used to be that college football is only a Saturday game, and that college basketball, some conferences they were Thursday, Saturday, some conferences are Friday, Saturday, like the Ivy League, for example, and some conferences are Wednesday, Saturday. For the most part, the Big Ten was a Wednesday, Saturday conference. The Atlantic 10, when Penn State was in there, was a Wednesday, Saturday conference. That way fans can count on it. Now you're playing almost every day of the week. I believe that next season for Penn State basketball, the only day of the week they will not play is Friday. I already know they have a Monday game. The Barclays tournament's a Monday, Tuesday. But television dictates all of that. And going back to Dan Patrick's point about shorter seasons, players resting, and so forth. To me, you can rest all the players you want, but I think the rule ought to be, if you want to rest them at home.
Yeah, we don't talk too much about NBA here, but I thought it was interesting this morning when the first playoff matchups and times were announced. The Milwaukee-Toronto series, you're going to catch at least three of those games, three minimum, on NBA TV. The suits... Not our suit, but their suits. I guess they think Milwaukee, Toronto. Yeah, not a lot of people are going to turn on ABC primetime for that game.
Right. No, it's everything is dictated by what television wants. Now, for the NBA and the NHL, they want to be able to put on what they perceive to be attractive matchups. Thus, you will see on ABC and on ESPN and on TNT when it comes to prime games, San Antonio, Golden State, the Celtics, and the Cavaliers will be the four teams that will consistently make it to ABC, ESPN, and TNT. Those will be the four that will make it somewhere. San Antonio, Cleveland, Golden State, and the Celtics. And Toronto against the Bucks. Man, I'm not so sure even in Milwaukee how much interest there is, but that's a different... That's a different argument. So you're absolutely right. Those are the games that end up on NBA TV. So they're trying to take advantage of it by putting those matchups there. But when it comes to the regular season, I think the NBA ought to sit down and look around and say, yo, you want to rest players? Rest them at home. And the reason that you rest them at home is this. In the regular season, you have 41 of those. If you pick three of them and they play 38 out of the 41, your season ticket base has now seen them 38 times. As opposed to, we're going to make the one trip into Miami this year. Oh, and by the way, we're not playing our starters. Well, don't the fans of Miami deserve to see stars? They probably bought tickets to see it. It's one of the better things the NHL has done. The NHL went from a regionalized schedule to going back to a national schedule where everybody plays everyone in everyone else's building. For example, Philadelphia this year got to see Connor McDavid, Patrick Laine. You know, two players that are thoroughly outstanding from the West. They're exciting young stars. I get to see them in their building this year. Same thing in Pittsburgh. Out West, there was a swing where the Penguins went to Edmonton, Vancouver, and then Calgary. Well, all the fans out there got a chance to see Sidney Crosby play along with Geno Malkin. It's the only time they're going in, but they got a chance to see him. And I think that's a big plus. When that happens, that's when you're really marketing your game nationally. If you want to rest players, I think you should rest them for home games. Because guess what? That's your season ticket base. Those are your, instead of seeing them 41 times, you see it 38. Just my opinion about how to solve that. Or do it in your own conference where you're making multiple trips in someplace. I know the game's hard enough, and I know the back-to-backs are wrong. I've never, the back-to-backs in hockey, the back-to-backs in the NBA. Seasons spread out over a long period of time. There's got to be a way to avoid some of that stuff. There has to be. And, I know we always hear scheduling is so hard. The Manhattan Project was hard. Scheduling is not in the same realm. We'll come back with more in a moment here on News Radio 1070 WKOK.
Get outside and clean up the yard.
Yes, dear.
Springtime means cleanup time, even at Sundary Motors Ford. Sundary Motors Spring Inventory Cleanup has begun. Once a year, SMC takes their entire new Ford inventory and prices them at levels not seen before. SMC is where you want to be to choose from 33 Ford Escapes starting at $19,380. Sundary Motors has sold over 40,000 new Ford trucks in the past 102 years. SMC is where you want to be to choose from over 4 city blocks of new Ford trucks. F-150s starting at an amazing $24,919. SMC is where you want to be if you want a brand new Ford Focus from $14,835. SMC is where you want to be for a 2017 Edge starting at $27,420. SMC has your next Ford Explorer ready to roll at an unheard of $29,835. Sunbury Motors Ford in the North 4th Street Auto Plaza, Sunbury. SMC, satisfying more customers, selling more cars. A tradition of trust since 1915.
Trout season starts Saturday, and so does the beverage season with a stop at Brewer's Outlet, the Beverage Supermarket. Catch a Jenny 30-pack for $12.95. That's a Jenny 6-pack of cans for only $2.59. Red's Variety 12-packs, $9.95. Shiner Variety 12-packs, $9.95. Line and Kugel 12-packs, $9.95. And, of course, a large selection of imports and microbrews. Get your soda, snacks, cigars, hot sauce, fresh roasted peanuts, and, of course, the pickle bar. Why shop anywhere else? It's Jenny, $2.59 a 6-pack at Brewer's Outlet, Reagan's Street, Sunbury.
Yeah, the seasons are long. I mean, there's no question about that. But people also are buying tickets for these long seasons, too. I mean, let's not forget that. People are buying tickets to see it. Maybe not everywhere, but they are buying tickets to see it. But there's such an overlap now in seasons, and I'll be honest with you, to me, the sport that has suffered more than anything else in terms of national perception on overlap has been baseball. Baseball gets started, they have opening day, and then after that, you've got playoff time I mean, this year was baseball's opening day, and then all of a sudden it was the national championship game in college basketball, which got a huge rating. And then the NBA and the Stanley Cup playoffs get underway, and baseball gets cast to the back because it's early in the season. They finally get an opportunity to get the sports world to itself, and they do that for about 5 weeks, and then, of course, they stop it for a period of time because when they stop it, they have it for the All-Star break, and the All-Star break's longer now than it used to be. Well, you don't play Monday, you don't play Wednesday, you don't play Thursday. And then they get back to work, and then pro football training camp begins. And when pro football training camp begins, America really then turns its attention to everything that is going on. I mean, Sean's a perfect example. I mean, you know, the Steelers play the opener, and Ben Roethlisberger may play a series or two, but everybody wants to see, that's a Steeler fan, how's Landry Jones doing? That's the nature of the football fan. Penn State will play the blue-white game next week. When they play the blue-white game next week, you'll see Trace McSorley, but a lot of fans will want to see, how's Tommy Stevens doing? How's Jake Zembeck doing? You'll come out for the blue-white game. You already know what Deshaun Hamilton can do, but, man, we've been hearing good things about Juwan Johnson. I can't wait to watch him in the blue-white game. Just an example. Football has that, and it has that effect on people that want to come out. I mean, yeah, I know football and the NFL viewing was down, what, 8% last year. We'll see how that plays out this year. You know, no election year. But they have to do a couple of things. The pro game has become very homogenized. You have the best athletes playing it, you know, the best football playing athletes. But at the same time, they don't do a lot of things that are different. You know, here it is, the end of April. End of April coming up. What are we going to have at the end of April? Well, we're going to talk about the 4 o'clock half hour, the draft. All the draft is reading off the names of players and where they're going. That's all it is. Yet people are enthralled by it. I mean, Sean, again, which no-name defensive lineman will the Steelers pick? You're excited.
Oh, very excited. I mean, it used to be, I mean, for decades ago, it was Pete Rozelle in front of a whiteboard. I mean, this year it's going to be in front of the Museum of Art in Philadelphia. I mean, it's turned into such just a huge event.
It is a huge event. And the NFL has the ability to take something that is mundane and turn it into a huge event.
Suit predicts the Steelers will take a quarterback in the third round. Not really sure about that.
Does the suit know yet whether the ball is stuffed or inflated?
Minor inflated?
If he can answer correctly, then I'll, you know. I guess what you're telling me, Suit Light now throws the javelin?
Taking your calls at 800-795-9565. This is the Steve Jones Show on News Radio 1070 WKOK. Now from the Sunbury Motors Studio, here's Steve Jones.
Sunbury Motors, 4th Street in Sunbury. Sunbury Motors, Key Routes 11 and 15 in Hummel's Wharf. Ben Jones, StateCollege.com in just a few moments. NFL draft preview next half hour. This day in sports history, 1954, Hank Aaron debuted with the Milwaukee Braves. 1957, the Celtics won their first NBA championship. They beat the St. Louis Hawks 125-123 in Game 7. 1963, the Mets played their first home game. The game was played at the Polo Grounds. And it turned out that you go to 2009, the Mets opened their season in Citi Field for the first time in the state. Also in 1963, Pete Rose of the Cincinnati Reds got his first major league hit. 1972, major league owners and players agreed not to make up games lost to a player strike. It was the first strike in the history of the major leagues. Players walked off the field 13 days earlier. 1979, the world's longest doubles ping pong match ended after 101 hours. 1986, Jack Nicklaus, at the age of 46, won his sixth Masters. And then, turn the clock ahead 11 years later, Tiger Woods blitzes the field at the age of 21, 18 under par, tournament record 270, to win his first green jacket. And that is this day in sports history. Let's bring in Ben Jones, statecollege.com. Ben, I'm actually going to start out with basketball. The Nittany Lions have signed 6'8 forward Trent Buttrick. He signed his letter of intent earlier this week. What's the read you have on him?
I think he's one of those guys that you get him because he fills a lot of the opportunity need that you have. Penn State originally, when Trent had verbaled, they just had this one scholarship for 2017. But he's 6'8", he's 220 pounds, he's got a Pennsylvania tie, he's playing basketball in Florida. He's a guy that, I feel like, with what Penn State has at the forward position, what they've got with some of their big men, you can take a guy like Trent and work with him, because you're not going to get a lot of 6'8 guys. They're going to want to, there are a lot of 6'8 guys out there, but you're going to be able to hang on to them and work with them and see what sort of ceiling you can get out of them. So I kind of see him, and maybe the staff sees him differently, but as a guy that's sort of a low risk, potentially a high reward sort of situation. He's got size, he's got strength, he shoots it pretty well. But considering the guys that are on the roster ahead of him, you give him some time to work in the system, get some work in the weight room, and then you see what you've got with him a year or two down the road. But again, I think ultimately, when you can find a guy who's 6'8", 220 pounds, and wants to play for you, you're going to take him. And I think because of the situation that Penn State had at the time, where 2017 class is not going to be all that big, you offer to what you've got, and they ended up with Trent Buttrick.
Well, I've said that Penn State basketball doesn't need an overhaul. They need some complementary parts to go what they have now to maybe swing three or four games. So how do you look at where they are right now as a program?
I think it's going to be interesting to see what they do in the next couple of weeks, the next couple of months with this sort of open transfer market. I think losing Peyton Banks is, obviously Peyton didn't shoot the ball as well last year as I think people expected him to and as well as he would have liked to. But I think anytime you've got a guy who's played Big Ten basketball for several years, anytime that you lose veteran presence, that's not going to help you. And I think, Peyton is a guy on both ends of the floor that for all of the sometimes the offensive struggles that he had finding his stroke from three, he's a guy that's going to bring you a lot of experience and a lot of things that you can't just replace with players that are out there on the market. So I think it's going to be interesting because I think there's no doubt that Penn State has got the pieces that it needs from the core standpoint. You obviously know what these freshmen or now sophomores bring to the table. And it's going to be interesting to see what Satchel Pierce does down low, what Mike Watkins is able to build on. But you lose guys that have been around for a while, and that's not something that you can just replace overnight. So I think, it's going to be interesting to see if they can get some guys to come in and honestly to find some guys that come in that fit into the mold, because I think you look historically, Penn State's been a little hit or miss with the guys that they've had transferring in, the grad transfers and what have you. So there's no guarantee that bringing someone in is going to be the answer, but certainly, if I'm remembering correctly, they're going, as it stands today, they're going into next season with 10 guys, so they're going to have to pick some people up, just have the warm bodies on the bench.
Well, for Banks, down the stretch, it was not pretty. He was 9 for his last 48 from the field and 19% in the stretch run was a problem, no question. But he also is going to get his degree, and he'll be able to grad transfer someplace, and he'll be, I think, a good complimentary part for somebody who wants to pick him up for 1 year. Let's get to football. Chance to hear from James Franklin and some players yesterday. What is your take on what they're telling you?
I think ultimately it's more or less what you would expect. The spring is, no news is good news kind of time of year for any college football team, let alone Penn State. But I think at the same time, you know, we got to talk to Trace yesterday, and things seem farther along this year than they were at this time last year. And that's what you would expect, you know, having a new offensive coordinator. And I think people forget that, you know, technically Brent Pry was a new defensive coordinator too, even though that transition, I think, for the most part was pretty seamless.
Mm-hmm.
So I think you see a team that's just a little bit more confident. And obviously when you have the kind of year that they had, you know, when you come out the other end and go into next season with a lot of, you know, the main parts that you had, and everybody for the most part, you know, obviously John Reed seems like he's going to be out for the year, but for the most part, you know, everybody's healthy, everybody's confident, and everybody's, you know, farther along. I think you just see a team that is, you know, they look like, I think when you watch some of these other programs that have been at least more established in the past 5 or so years, they're not doing anything overly flashy in spring ball. They're not doing anything, you know, different than what everyone else is doing, but they just look confident. They look the part. And I think when you watch Penn State, they look sharper. They look more confident. And I think that goes a long way because I think, you know, I was talking to somebody this morning about, you know, the Penn State team at the end of last year would have wiped the floor with the Penn State team at the beginning of last year. And I think, you know, you see that team at the end of last year, and do they make that kind of huge, you know, arc of improvement from game one to game 12, you know, that remains to be seen because they're going to be pretty good right out of the gate. But certainly, I think ultimately what you see is a team that's confident and you really ought to.
When you've had a chance to just observe, I mean, you haven't had big windows to observe, but what are a couple things that you'll be looking for in 9 days when they go to the blue-white game based on a couple of observations you've had from practice?
Yeah, I mean, you know, we heard yesterday from Grant Haley that Lamont Wade right now, you know, leads the team in spring ball interceptions. And I think he's a guy, you know, Lamont, that is, that, you know, people are interested to see what he brings to the table at corner and maybe even a little bit at safety. You know, especially with John Reed being out, they have to find somebody, a Christian Campbell and Imani, one of these guys to step up into that spot. And I think, you know, realistically, the blue-white game isn't going to change anybody's career. And by the time, you know, the season gets here, no one's going to remember most of what they saw. But I think for the most part, you know, this is an opportunity to see some of these younger guys, because you've got to think that Saquon and Trace and Mike Gesicki aren't going to take a ton of snaps. And if at all, you know, I wouldn't be surprised if Saquon doesn't even dress to a certain extent. But, you know, it's going to be interesting to see what some of these younger guys can do. You know, maybe what a guy like, you know, some of the younger linebackers, what K.J. Hamler can do at receiver, what Mike Miranda does on the offensive line, some of these younger guys, because this is really their opportunity to showcase their talent. And really, you know, he is a guy that, you know, I almost feel bad for him, because Tommy Stevens can throw that football. And
oh,
it's
yes,
be
he
fun
can.
To watch him do that. And he doesn't get nearly enough credit for that. Obviously, you know, I'm not saying that he should play instead of Trace or anything like that, but that kid's a talented football player. So I'm looking forward to seeing him throw it around and see what some of these younger guys can do, because you never know. I mean, you turn some heads in front of, you know, however many people they get out there. You know, that's the one last opportunity going into the summer to make a good impression in front of this coaching staff. So I don't think we'll learn anything about Penn State in terms of what they'll look like in September, but maybe some of that depth on the roster and some guys to keep an eye on for this year later in the season or later in their careers. I think that's the biggest thing for a blue-white game.
Well, Tommy Stevens, to me, is an invaluable member of this program. I mean, really, I mean, I think every program in this conference would love to have a guy like that in the spot he's in. I mean, I just think he's that good.
Hey, absolutely.
Go ahead.
Yeah, no, absolutely. I think Tommy Stevens is a guy, even, you know, if he decided to leave tomorrow, and I don't think there's any indication that he would do that, there would be a lot of programs that would be happy to have him, not only in a backup role, but I think, you know, there's a lot of places he could start. So hopefully, you know, just for his sake, someday down the road, he gets that opportunity.
Always a pleasure, Ben. Thanks so much.
Yep, thanks for having me, Steve.
And that's Ben Jones, StayCollege.com. Next half hour, NFL Draft. We'll talk about that in a moment as we continue on News Radio 1070 WKOK. All right, the blue-white game will take place a week from Saturday at Beaver Stadium. 3 o'clock will be the start for the scrimmage. And we'll have it for you here on News Radio 1070 WKOK at 3. It'll last, the whole thing, when it's all said and done, will be about 2 hours. And hopefully you can make it to the game. We'd love to see you out there. So I always enjoy when I drive into a game. And, you know, obviously if it's a nice day and the initial forecast looks decent. I always enjoy, I'll be in line on Park Avenue And I'll look as I'm going by car after car, or a car is going by me on the left. Mom, dad, kids. Mom, dad, kids. Mom, dad, kids. I love seeing that. You know, that's the those youngsters, for example. The adults are excited about going to Beaver Stadium because they probably went when they were kids too. But I mean, think of, you know, put yourself in the shoes of a 7 to 12 year old kid. Yeah, you get to go to Beaver Stadium, get to watch the blue-white game, have some fun, throw the ball around the parking lot. Blue-white game's over, you get to run on the field. It's a kind of experience that stays with you. And I always think that that is one of the really neat things about the blue-white game. Yeah, you know, there's an autograph session, so yeah, you might get a chance to meet Saquon Barkley. Yeah, you might get a chance to meet Trace McSorley or Jason Kabinda. You'll probably get a good long look at guys like Juwan Johnson and Irv Charles and Jonathan Holland and Andre Robinson and people like that. I mean, you'll get a good long look at guys like that. But think of that 7 to 12-year-old, you know, the excitement that morning of getting up and driving to Beaver Stadium. You know, maybe you went last year. Maybe this is the first time they've ever gone. Get to the parking lot. Great. Get tailgates going on. They're throwing the ball around. They go into the stadium. Remember the first time you as a youngster walked into a ballpark or a stadium? You saw that green grass. Right? And then all of a sudden they come out of the tunnel or in baseball, the dugout, take batting practice or, in this case, warming up for a football game. Then you watch the thing, and then when it's over with, they actually let you walk in the field. It's a great experience for a youngster. And that's when I drive in, that's what I see. I see mom, dad, kids. Mom, dad, kids. Next car, mom, dad, kids. It really sticks out to me about that experience, the Beavers, the blue-white game, Beaver Stadium experience. That's what stands out to me more than the play. Because you have to remember that for you, I completely understand that for you, the fan, completely understand, this is your one time to really see them. So I completely get that. Completely. And I hope you understand that for me, it's practice 15, and what I saw in the previous 14 were probably far more significant than 15. Now, there is another element to it, though, with a big crowd. The one thing I didn't see, or will not see in the previous 14, is how will some of these young players react with a huge crowd there? I've watched them react in a controlled environment. Now is the first time they've reacted in front of a big crowd. So that part does interest me as to who's able to translate and be calm and dependable in an environment like that, because the previous 14 were in a controlled environment. So that is something I do look for as to how do they react in front of you. Because all of you in the tens of thousands aren't there providing some atmosphere of practice. They have to create that. They have to create that. So that part does interest me. Very, very much, as a matter of fact. And I love the... I sit there and I was on the phone with Jack Ham yesterday, maybe. And Jack's coming up here tomorrow. We're going to go to practice tomorrow. And we were talking about the crowd for the blue-white game. And, of course, James Franklin would like to have what they have at Ohio State. Ohio State does sell out its Scarlet and Gray game. They've done it the last 3-4 years now. Well, James would love to see that at Penn State. Love to see 107,000 show up for the game. and we were talking about that aspect, and I said to Jack, I said, the blue-white game, I said, is amazing. I said, if the USFL had those kind of crowds about 30-some-odd years ago, I said, they'd still be in existence today. But they have, let's see, they'll go tomorrow. Then they go, and that will get them, I think that gets them to 12. So they have three more next week, and one of them is the blue-white game. So that's how it works.
A reporter did ask Coach last night about a practice in the stadium. Didn't know if that was going to be tomorrow or if they already did have one in the stadium.
No, it's tomorrow.
Okay. Okay.
Yeah. They haven't gone in the...
I remember you told me they always have one before blue-white.
They always have. I mean, they want to get them in there just to, you know... I mean, let's take certain guys, for example. Mike Miranda, who was singled out by James Franklin last night. Mike Miranda's never set foot on the Beaver Stadium field with pads on. Never. You know, somebody like, Aaron Monroe has only had limited exposure out there. Lamont Wade has never stepped onto the field at Beaver Stadium wearing pads and a helmet in front of a crowd there. Never. You know, Jake Zembeck was on the sideline, but he hasn't actually physically been in anything in there before. So, I mean, he does want to get them into the stadium one time. And it's also great for the kickers, too. It's great for the kickers to get in there just to get, again, you know, just a little familiarity with the wind. The wind's a little bit different now in there. And ever since they built that south end in 2001, the wind now kicks around and swirls in that stadium. It was never like that before they built the club seats and the upper deck in the south end. It used to be it would come out of the north, it would funnel through that upper deck, and it was a definite north-to-south wind all the time. And even before they had the upper deck on the north end, it was a north-to-south wind in there. But once they put that building up on the south end and opened it up in 2001 with the club seats and the upper deck above it, that wind now comes in there, funnels through the north deck, hits that thing, and swirls around that stadium. So it's good for the quarterbacks to get used to a little bit of that. It's good for the kickers to get used to that. All right, next half hour, we'll talk about the NFL draft. The suit is predicted that the Steelers will trade up for the number one pick and go for a quarterback. That's what he said, right? Did I mishear him? Because when he started talking, I started leaving the room, so I may have missed it.
No, you're good.
Well, the second he told us that Suit Light was throwing the javelin, I mean, was there a moment of fear that went through you two? I mean, that's a spear. Lanzerian, NFL Network, next half hour. NFL media analyst and provides live coverage of the 2017 NFL Draft from Philadelphia.
We are your home for the Philadelphia Phillies. News Radio 1070 WKOK Sunbury.